Welcome back to Ring of Fire. I'm Robert F. Kennedy Jr. Very little is known about many of the activities of the CIA, and even the stories that are revealed in the press aren't able to give us the entire picture of what this agency is doing behind the scenes. But a new book recently released helps shed some light on those issues, and they're issues that many Americans are dying to know about. I'm joined now by author and former CIA attorney John Rizzo to tell those stories. John is the author of a new book, Company Man, 30 Years of Controversy and Crisis in the CIA. Welcome to the show, John.
Thank you, Bobby. It's good to be here.
Now, you know, when the CIA was established back in 1947, or right after World War II, there were many Americans who were worried that having a spy agency was inconsistent with a democracy. People associated with both Republicans and Democrats with that internal or secret police and spy agencies were the province of, you know, the Soviet KGB or the East German Stasi or the Iranian Savak or the German Gestapo, and that it's not something that you could really, that was consistent with democracy. And then in 1970, the early 70s, 73 to 75, you had the Church Committee hearings, which exposed many of the kind of the sins, what they call the family jewels of the CIA, the use of psychotic drugs on Americans, the use of torture, and the overthrow of democratic regimes in Guatemala, in Iran, in Indonesia, and many, many other places. You know, you joined at that time, and I would describe you, having read your book, as kind of a true believer, that you really believe in the mission of this agency. Tell me whether that's true, and also whether you see any threat to American values from a secret agency like the CIA.
Well, I certainly am a true believer. You know, I've literally spent more than half my life working at the CIA. I worked with three generations of CIA officers, so you know, I wholly believe in the mission, and I never saw CIA posing a threat to American values. As you mentioned, spy, by its very nature, a spy organization, one would think it'd be sort of counterintuitive to a democratic society. But as you know, Bobby, every nation in the world, Democratic and non-democratic, have spy agencies. It's just it's just always been deemed as essential to protecting the country.
Let's explore that. And what does it mean to protect the country? Because even in recent years, you know, when I think of America, I think not only of the landscapes and the people, but principally of the values that our country is supposed to represent, and many of those are expressed in the Bill of Rights of the Constitution, including jury trials and habeas corpus and the right to be free of unwarranted searches and seizures and the right to trial to representation by an attorney, the right not to be tortured, cruel and unusual punishment. We also have treaties that express those values that really were born in America. The Geneva Convention was an American invention, but, you know, it started with Abraham Lincoln. The Convention Against Torture was an American invention, and it was signed by Ronald Reagan. And all of those values have been trampled in recent years by the behavior of the security agencies. And that's what I think was the worry of Americans back in the 40s when this was started, including Harry Truman. Harry Truman said, I never intended to sign into law an agency that would be meddling in other people's business and buying elections and overthrowing people and having secret military wars and all these. He was trying to create an espionage agency, in other words, one that would provide intelligence to the president. But somehow the tail began wagging the dog, and it has damaged American values.
Well, I guess I would respectfully disagree on that. Of those that list of things that you just cited, I suppose the one is most relevant in my experience. My time was, of course, those years after 9/11, when I was the chief legal officer at CIA, and when the post 9/11 years, when the CIA interrogation program, including the waterboarding, that in fact began under my watch. So no question about that. All I can tell you about that is as a lawyer, first of all, the program was constructed in very perilous times, just a few months after 9/11, when, as you recall, the entire nation was gripped with fear and dread that another major attack on the homeland was imminent. So there was a consensus in the country, in the Congress, and I believe among the American people, that another attack, I mean, had to be stopped at virtually any cost. And so this program was conceived basically because we had captured our first high-level Al-Qaeda operative that our experts, our career CIA experts, were convinced, one, if there was going to be a second attack, this guy would know about it, and two, that he was making it clear that we couldn't make him talk, and he wasn't going to tell us. So, in that turbulent, terrifying era, extraordinary measures had to be conceived and used. They did not, in my view, I didn't believe that then, and still don't believe it, that they, while unquestionably harsh and sometimes brutal, they did not amount to torture.
John, this is really interesting. Your book is very interesting. Can we take a quick break and come back and talk a little bit more?
Absolutely.
We'll be right back with more from author and former CIA attorney John Rizzo. I'm Robert F. Kennedy Jr., and you're listening to Ring of Fire. Welcome back. This is Robert F. Kennedy Jr. on Ring of Fire. And right now, my guest is John Rizzo, the former CIA attorney and spook who designed orchestrated the torture memos. And he has now written a book called Company Man, 30 Years of Controversy and Crisis in the CIA. I remember back in the 70s when our ship, the Pueblo, was captured by the North Koreans, and they isolated some of the crew in their rooms, and we called that torture. And we, in fact, have executed people after World War II, Japanese, because they waterboarded people. And waterboarding has been illegal in many states. In fact, it was a capital crime in Texas, and there was a sheriff who was executed for it. So, I don't think there's anybody who's endured waterboarding who would say it's not torture. But I understand that there was a legal construct which you helped supervise or implement that said that essentially tried to get around the Convention Against Torture and around the Geneva Convention and around the prohibitions on cruel and unusual punishment, and as you say in your book, to give cover to the operatives at CIA who were engaging in this. And I understand that the motivation for that was to protect our country. But, you know, isn't there a cost to our country all over the world? And hasn't there been a cost from Abu Ghraib, from Guantanamo? Those have become recruiting devices for the terrorists.
No, I wouldn't dispute the fact that America has suffered in a world opinion because of those events, and you know, I would argue the fact that the CIA interrogation program, once it was first leaked and then disclosed, probably continued to contribute to that degree of mistrust. So I don't dispute that. What I'm saying, I guess, is that, you know, as a lawyer, you know, I submitted this whole program to the Department of Justice. I didn't know how they were going to conclude. I personally, in my previous 25 years at CIA, had to become, mercifully, conversant with the torture statute, so I didn't know where the lines were. Now, if the Justice Department had come back and said, you know, waterboarding and the other things fit the legal definition of torture, then we wouldn't have done it. I mean, I got the memos. You mentioned the cover. I got the memos, you know, frankly.
But isn't that like, I mean, isn't that the Nuremberg defense? Isn't that just saying, I mean, because a child who, anybody who saw waterboarding would know it's torture. John McCain, when he was being described, he said, it's torture, it's torture. Everybody who's looked at this has said, you know, from a neutral standpoint, has said it is torture. And plus the other things that, you know, were as bad as waterboarding, the sleep deprivation, the sound and the light assaults, the freezing, the heating, all of these, you know, the standing for hours, all of these are things that people recognize as torture. But what lawyers did, and this is kind of lawyers at their worst, is to try to find a way to define this so that it would be okay, even though their humanity and their common sense told them this is torture. We want to torture people, so we are going to invent a legal justification for it. Isn't that exactly the Nuremberg defense? Isn't that what we said at Nuremberg when the Nazis said, you know, who had tortured people in various ways, when they said, well, we were ordered to do this, or we were told that it was legally okay to do this. And we said, no, 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 no. You have to make your own judgment about whether this is right or wrong. And we're going to hold you to your humanity, not to some contrived legal construction that somebody, you know, has produced to allow you to do something that is clearly evil and against our values.
Yeah, I mean, well, again, I would respectfully dissent from equating what CIA did in the post-9/11 era to Nuremberg and the Nazis, who were on trial, as you know, for the systematic extermination of an entire...
Well, some of them were on trial for torturing people. That's all. And they were executed for it. And it was the same thing. And they didn't kill Jews, and they didn't engage in genocide. They just tortured people. And we put them on trial for it. And we told them that saying that your officer, that your a superior officer ordered you to do it, was not a defense.
Yeah, no, I take your point. I just, the program that we conducted, as I say, I mean, it was harsh, it was brutal. I don't question that, but it was not. I mean, I can only speak for myself, ultimately, but I certainly did not go into it contriving to figure out a way so we could torture people. I mean, that was not the point of the program.
Well, let me say this: is there any place where you would have drawn a line if? Because you say, well, you know, we checked this with the Justice Department and they said it was okay. And we know that, you know, you had, you know, Jonathan Yu and Bybee and the people in Cheney's office and Rumsfeld's office who had these collection of lawyers who were essentially just cranking out secret memos that the public did not see and did not debate. And they were cranking out memos trying to justify this. Is there any place where you would have drawn the line and said, we can't, even though the Justice Department says we can do this, we can't do it?
Well, I mean, if there have been techniques, I mean, I wouldn't speculate what those techniques were, but if there were techniques being proposed, you know, pulling out fingernails or gouging eyes and By the way, what the CIA program was, it had nothing to do with and was different from what went on in Abu Ghraib, which was purely, in my view, observation, you know, purely sadistic behavior. But if there had been, it wasn't a blank check bombing. I mean, these were the techniques that were authorized, and they were also embedded with all of the most senior policymakers in the Bush administration, the National Security Council, you know, after they had been legally approved by justice. And, you know, there could have been, you know, policy reasons for people not to have gone along with them, but no one in the senior ranks of government, and actually at that time, none of the congressional leaders we briefed on the program, for the first couple, 3 years at least, expressed any objections to them. Now, one can look back in retrospect and say that I or someone else should have stood up and said, well, even though this is all these things are technically legal, we don't want to do them. And we did.
Well, the congressional leaders actually were bound not to discuss what they heard in their intelligence briefings, no matter how kind of reprehensible or shocking that they found it. Hey, John, would you be willing to stay with us and listen to our news? Because this is so interesting. I'd love to talk to you some more after our news segment.
Absolutely.
Welcome back to Ring of Fire. You've just heard the news. And before the news, we were talking with John Rizzo. We're going to continue that interview. If you missed it, you can go to ringoffireradio.com and listen to our podcast. John, welcome back to the show. This is John Rizzo, who is a former CIA attorney and one of the authors of the infamous torture memos. He's written a book called Company Man, 30 Years of Controversy and Crisis in the CIA. You call yourself a true believer, and you love this agency, clearly. And your expressions of respect for the agency leadership, one after the other, Democrats and Republicans, is spread throughout the book. Let me just give you, playing devil's advocate here, let me talk about the record of the CIA historically, just give you some of the highlights and talk about the concept of blowback. About, you know, you said at the beginning of the show, every nation has to have a spy agency. But at some point, the intelligence agency should have to justify its own record. And let me talk about some of the highlights that occur to me. The day that my uncle was inaugurated, the CIA conspired, although that was the Belgian intelligence agency, in the murder of Patrice Lumumba, who was the George Washington of the Congo. Everybody agreed he was the only leader that could keep the Congo together. And he was murdered. And the Congo has been suffering ever since. The CIA in 1953 overthrew the first democratically elected president of Iran in 4,000 years of its history. Mossadegh, at the behest of BP oil, Truman had refused to do it. When Eisenhower came in, Allen Dulles set loose the dogs of war and overthrew this very, very popular anti-colonial nationalist person who had thrown out the British because they were trying to overthrow him, but he loved the Americans and trusted us because he saw us as an anti-colonial power too. The year after that, the CIA overthrew Jacobo Arbenz in Guatemala, probably the best democratic leader in the history of Central America. Guatemala, again, has never recovered from that. We attempted to overthrow Sukarno, and that damaged our relationship, again, at the behest of mining, mineral, and oil companies. That damaged our relationship with Indonesia up until the present. The CIA missed the major, you know, they missed the H-bomb from the Soviets by 12 years, the A-bomb from China by 14 years. They missed the Iran coup in 1979. They missed 9/11. They missed the issue of weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. Timothy Weiner, who is a big fan of the CIA and has written a book called Legacy of Ashes, but he's reported on the CIA for the New York Times for years, wrote this. He said, during all the Cold War years, the CIA never had a success in recruiting a single spy who could give the agency of the U.S. government genuine insights into the working of the Kremlin. During this period, the number of Soviet spies with important information to reveal, all of them volunteers, none of them recruited, could be counted on the fingers of two hands, and all of them, everyone died, was captured, and executed by Moscow. You know, what do you think of when you hear that kind of assessment from somebody who's generally sympathetic to the CIA? But this issue of blowback, that when we do these kind of operations, that there's unintended consequences that hurt our democracy and our national interests.
Yeah. Well, Bobby, you covered a lot of time and a lot of ground there. Let me just try to concisely respond. With respect to Tim Weiner and that quote you had, first of all, I don't challenge or dispute any of those events you listed. All of them up until 1975. They all took place before I arrived there, so I know just about as much about those as in the public record. But first of all, I would dispute the fact that Tim Weiner is a longtime advocate for CIA. That's a terrific book he wrote, but it is. The part you cite is basically a central thesis for the book, which is his right. But, you know, it is a cliche, but I found it's also true that CIA follies, misadventures, screw-ups are, always come to light sooner or later. But the many successes, the many ways CIA helped win the Cold War and helped in the 9/11 era, and even before that, a lot of those remain secret and classified. I know that it may sound very, very convenient to say, but it's true. Every president, from Harry Truman on, came to trust and rely and use the CIA extensively. Sometimes these operations were blowback, and they did blow up in the country's faces. But there are many other times where the CIA did and continues to perform a valuable and, in my view, irreplaceable mission in this country.
John, I don't mean to interrupt, but we got to go to a break. We're talking with John Rizzo, the author of Company Man, 30 Years of Controversy and Crisis in the CIA. We'll be right back. I'm Robert F. Kennedy Jr., and you're listening to Ring of Fire. Welcome back to Ring of Fire. We're talking with CIA spook John Rizzo, who's just written a book about his three decades at the CIA, Company Man, 30 Years of Controversy and Crisis in the CIA. Let me ask you to respond to something about an idea about American history. During the Revolutionary War, George Washington, when, the British were torturing American soldiers and officers and killing them by the dozens daily in prison ships in New York Harbor, Washington was asked by some of his officers about torturing British officers who had knowledge that could have helped in the war effort. And he was so repulsed by the idea that he said it would be better for us to forfeit our cause than to sully it with behavior that would reflect poorly on our democracy and our nation. And he meant torturing people. And he treated the Hessian soldiers so kindly that he had captured on New Year's Day that they walked voluntarily without guards all the way to prison camps in western Pennsylvania. And many of them ended up staying in our country. The same thing happened during the Civil War. Abraham Lincoln was so aghast at suggestions that they torture Confederate soldiers that he ordered protocols created for the fair treatment, humane treatment of prisoners of war, and that ultimately became the Geneva Convention. During World War II, President Eisenhower said that, again, even though the Nazis were torturing our troops, that we weren't going to do that. We're going to treat them as we wanted our troops treated. And during that war, thousands of German soldiers surrendered to Americans because they had heard from their fathers who fought in World War I. Always surrender to Americans because Americans don't torture people. Now, isn't that a legacy we should be proud of? Isn't that a legacy that we should try to sustain?
Sure. No, it is a legacy to be proud of. But when we're talking post-9/11, Bobby, we have to keep in mind the kinds of people that were our enemy here. These were...
But you know, let me interrupt that, because you've said that three times, and... You know, I don't believe that. I don't believe that we're in any more danger today than we were in danger in 1780 when, you know, Washington's troops were barefoot, they were bleeding, they were walking in the winter, and our country had lost almost all of the battles, and we were about to be defeated. And he still refused to torture people during the Civil War. Our country was split in half. We almost lost that war. There were 660,000 Americans killed. It's the same as if 6 million people were killed today. During the Cold War, which I lived through, people were building bomb shelters. We were, you know, one person could have pressed a button that would have annihilated the entire human race. We were in much more danger then than we were after 9/11. But 9/11, you had a government that wanted to frighten the American people, to hype up the danger, and to tell us there's never been a danger like this before in history, so we have to do these extreme methods. If you actually looked at history, real history, we were in much more danger in other times in our history, and we didn't engage in those kind of measures. We did sometimes, but it was always an aberration. It was never by policy, and that really is what distinguished our 9/11 behavior and has now, you know, brought us disgrace across the world. You know, what would have happened if after 9/11, instead of launching this war against the world, we said... The intelligence agency said that the best way for us to improve security and to reduce the threat to America, to humanity, to improve quality of life in our country, to improve public health, to bolster our economy, and to restore our national prestige is to get off of oil. What if that was the report that went to the president? Oh, let's not get into wars. Let's get off of oil. Because after all, Osama bin Laden bombed us because we put troops in Saudi Arabia, at least this is what he said, after the first Gulf War, which was an oil war, which for the first President Bush said this war is about protecting our interests in oil. And so what if we just got off of the oil? I mean, the oil, our addiction to oil is, you know, we are funding essentially both sides of the war against terror. And we're giving people in the Mideast not only resources, but reason to look at us as the great Satan. Let's get off of it. Let's stop buying their stuff and let's switch to, you know, American energy production. What if the intelligence agencies had said that, and instead of, you know, looking around the world for trouble to get into, had come home and said, let's look at the feasibility of transitioning to solar, of transitioning to wind, of ending our dependence on the foreign oil that's getting us into all this trouble. Why isn't the intelligence agency giving us that kind of intelligence? Are they capable of giving us that kind of intelligence assessment?
Oh, sure. If that were their assessment, then that's the assessment they would have given. I honestly cannot accept the proposition that they 9/11 attacked them, but was driven by our oil policy. Or, you know, if we had come out on September 12th and said we're renouncing oil and we're going solar, I mean, do you honestly think that would have deterred bin Laden and his people? I mean, they issued a jihad against the Americans everywhere.
But why did, I mean, Osama bin Laden said that the reason that he was targeting, his original target was the king of Saudi Arabia. That's who he spent his life fighting against, and he hated Israel. He was battling against the Russians. He was battling against the Saudi Arabian crown, and that's where was his fixation. He began to fixate on the United States, according to him, and maybe you have information that this isn't true, but according to him, because we stationed permanent troops in the nation where Mecca is located. And he believed that that having foreign troops in the nation of Mecca was an unforgivable crime and that we had to be punished for that. That is what his story was. Now, if you know something different, that would be good for Americans to know, because otherwise, and why did we put our troops there? We put them there because of oil. And that, you know, there was the first president Bush, when he went to the first Gulf War, many Americans, including my uncle, challenged him and said, and John Kerry, and said, we are against this war. We are not going to give you a carte blanche to go into to protect Kuwait, which is a repressive, you know, monarchy, from an adjoining repressive monarchy, which is Saddam Hussein. You know, why is this even our business? And President Bush said, this is our business because the protection of oil pipelines in the Gulf of Hormuz and the Persian Gulf is a U.S. national security issue. And he called that the Bush Doctrine. So it was an oil war. Nobody disagreed with that. And because of that oil war, we left troops in Saudi Arabia to protect the Saudis from Saddam Hussein. And because we had troops there, it, according to Osama bin Laden, that's what infuriated him and caused him to bomb the World Trade Center. So did the CIA ever put together that chain of events and say, wait a minute, instead of spending $4.3 trillion on a war, why don't we spend $500 billion getting off of oil and building a national grid in our country that could carry these new forms of energy, spending $225 million building generating capacity? Why don't we look at the history? That's what intelligence agencies are supposed to do.
No, that's right. And again, what you described about what bin Laden was saying, what fueled his original hatred towards the United States in the early 90s, what, you know, did apparently emanate from Saudi Arabia. But there was, as far as I could, saw, and could, there was, he has not hit the World Trade Centers because of the U.S. oil policies. I mean, he hit it because he hated the United States. He had declared jihad against the United States.
But why? Everyone. Because he hated our freedoms?
Yes.
Really?
He hated the Western way of life.
Really? Do you think that's really why he didn't like people buying flat-screen TVs and that's why he bombed us? Because that's not what he said. That's what George Bush said. George Bush said he hates us for our freedoms. But he never said that. Osama bin Laden said he bombed us because we had boots on the ground in the land of Mecca. That's what he said. So I don't know. Do you have some special information that says he hated us for our freedoms? I mean, I know he believed that our culture was decadent, but, you know, he believed lots of nations were decadent. Why did he bomb the World Trade Center? You know, it's because, he made this clear in his statements, you know, on Al Jazeera. I'm doing this because they have boots on the ground in Mecca and because CIA policy has been, and U.S. foreign policy has been, not to spread democracy, but to protect the mercantile interests of U.S. corporations. And that's what Osama bin Laden said.
Yeah, no, that's right. That's what he said. I mean, honestly, I would not take Osama bin Laden at his word about anything. As I say, I'm sure, and he did have this hatred, part of the hatred would stem from the U.S. history you just cited. But all indications, all intelligence, I mean, his hatred was more inchoate and more visceral than that. He attacked the United States because he hated everything the United States stood for. It was the great Satan. Oil was only, frankly, a relatively small component of what he did. I mean, if that were the case, why didn't he attack in Saudi Arabia?
Well, he did attack Saudi Arabia. He was expelled from Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, in the early 90s, right.
Right, and he, you know, and that's because he was regarded as a threat to Saudi Arabia because that was his primary target until we put boots on the ground in Saudi Arabia, and then we became his target. John, thank you so much for joining us, and thanks for engaging in this spirited debate. John Rizzo is author of the new book, Company Man, 30 Years of Controversy and Crisis in the CIA. Thank you so much, John, for joining us.
Thank you, Bobby.